Good morning.
Good morning.
Is there any announcements? Yes, Pat.
We're planning our usual Easter egg hunt on Easter morning. And if anyone would like to contribute bags of candy, individually wrapped candy that we can put in the Easter eggs, we're asking for no chocolate cake because it'll probably be very warm and we don't want the chocolate to melt. There's a paper in the bag where you can sign up if you'd like to contribute.
So, Pat, let me ask you. Butterfingers don't count. The reason I ask, it's my favorite. Okay. Because if Butterfingers are included, I may come to the hunt. Okay. Any other announcements? Today, we have the great privilege of having Pastor Charles DeHaven with us. With that, he always brings a good message. So let's all pay attention to what he has to say, and we'll walk out of this door a little bit better this morning.
Great. Yeah. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And because my back is kind of wobbly, I'm going to spend most of my time over here so I don't stumble and fall. This is, of course, the first day of spring, right?
Yes.
Now, that means we got to have some rain soon. For those of us who are gardeners and everything of the like. So we pray for rain today. We pray for God's message to be here to inspire us. And living in Hondo, I always have to reflect as to how everybody's creeping our way. You've got so many people coming to this side of town and this side of Castroville. I hope someday this church is just filled with people. With all these new homes coming, and even in our area, they're just buying up land for development and everything else. And we were talking about, where do we go from here, you know? If everybody's coming here, where are we going, you know? So, let's stand and greet each other. Peace the Lord be with you. Peace, guys. Thank you, bud. Let me see if I think I put it on green. Oh, yeah, it's on green. I can speak loud. Yeah. Okay, while we figure out the mic, is it working now? Let us take a moment in silence as we prepare for our hearts and for our minds for worship. So, Lord, be with us as we worship you and lift up our hearts to you, and prayerfully you fill our hearts with the joy and peace that's yours to give. In Christ's name we say, Amen.
Amen.
And together we sing.
Early.
In the name of God who makes a way in the wilderness, who walks with us and guides us in our pilgrimage. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Holy One, we confess that we have wandered far from you. We have not trusted your promises. We have ignored your prophets in our own name. We have squandered our inheritance of grace. We have failed to recognize you in our midst. Have mercy on us. Forgive us and turn us again to you. Teach us to follow in your ways. Assure us again of your love. And help us to love our neighbor. Amen. Therefore, in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all of our sins. And therefore, as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Lord, King, and Father, unbegotten, true essence of the Godhead.
Have mercy on us.
Lord, fount of light and creator of all things.
Have mercy on us.
Lord, you have signed us with the seal of your image.
Have mercy on us.
Christ, your true God and true man.
Have mercy on us.
Christ, rising sun through whom all things were made.
Have mercy on us.
Christ, perfection of wisdom.
Have mercy on us.
Lord, life-giving spirit and power of life.
Have mercy on us.
Lord, breath of the Father and of the Son, in whom all things, have mercy upon us. Lord, you forgive our sins and you give us the grace of salvation.
Have mercy upon us.
So therefore, we sing glory to God.
Thank you.
Before we continue, I would ask that we remember and pray for the Wayne Newman and family and the loss of his mother, Maggie Newman, last Thursday, and our prayers be with Wayne and his family as we think about our prayer for the day. Eternal God, your kingdom has broken into our troubled world through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son. Help us to hear your word and obey it, and bring your saving love to fruition in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who reigns with you as the Holy and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you. God speaks to us in Scripture, reading, preaching, and song. Today's first reading comes from Isaiah 55. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you. Because of the Lord your God and of the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not my thoughts, neither are my ways his ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Here ends the reading. Let us read responsively Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you.
My soul thirsts for you, my flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water.
So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name I will lift up my hands.
My soul is satisfied with bread and rich food, and my mouth will praise you with joyfulness. And I
For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings, I will sing for joy.
My soul thanks you, your right hand holds me.
Today's second reading comes from 1 Corinthians. For I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud, and all passed through the cloud, and all were baptized into the cloud and in the sea. And all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not be idolatrous as some of them were, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did and were destroyed by serpents, nor grumble as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the ages has come. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he can stand take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. Here ends the reading. Please stand as you're able for the gospel acclamation and the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel, there it is according to Luke chapter 13, 1 through 9.
Glory to you, Lord.
There were some present at that very time who told him about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And he answered them, "Do you think these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in the way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Or those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you all likewise will perish." And he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. He came seeking fruit on it, and he found none. And so he said to the wine dresser, "Look, for these years I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and I have found none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground?" And he answered them, saying, "Sir, let it alone this year also, until I dig around it and put on some manure. Then it shall bear fruit next. If it bear fruit next year, well and good. But if not, cut it down." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We are seated as we continue with, I believe, the children's time. Very good. Somebody come.
No, that's all right. We don't need it today.
All right, she's done. Keep them busy.
Turn around. Y'all turn around. Face the congregation this morning. We'd like to invite a very special lady up that has ministered to these children and to all of you, I know. We'd like to have Garden Granny come up this morning.
Thank you.
You'll see. I woke you up. Right here. Okay, so you have ministered to these children. You've been a seed sower for many years now. They just want to tell you thank you and that they love you for all that you've done for them. We're retiring your hat. And here's a plant for your garden at home.
All I've been wanting.
But she can carry it for you if you like.
Thank y'all so much. I love y'all so much.
Y'all want to give her hugs? You have been a real blessing to these children and to this church.
I just wanted to love Jesus.
That's right. Love Jesus. When she handed this over to me, she goes, just make sure they know that Jesus loves them.
Thank y'all so much.
Oh. You make us cry. I mean, this is wonderful that you have done so much for these children today. All right. Thank you, kids, for coming up. All right, they wanted to make sure. Can we still get candy this morning?
A butterfinger.
You know why the Butterfinger's got a good name? Because when you try to eat it, if it's a hot day, it's butter all over your fingers, right? Well, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the midst of our broken world, perhaps more broken than most of us have ever experienced in our lives. But in spite of this brokenness, Lord, your word stands tall and true in the lives of the faithful people like Granny and others who passed on your words and your teachings. So we ask that you empower those of us to pick up the task of the generations before us and carry on with the truth and the gospel of Jesus Christ. In our Lord's name we can pray. Amen. One of my favorite things as a conservative person, and I'm a pastor that can say things and then run in case you're a liberal or something like that. But one of my favorite newspapers is the Epoch Times, and it's a conservative paper. And there was an article, I get so many sermon ideas from things I read, you know, alongside the Bible and church, of course. But there was an article here entitled, "I'm Crying All the Time Because My Heart Is So Full." Now that is a statement made by a retired lieutenant colonel named Kurt Miller. My heart is crying all the time. He's referring to the fact that he attended one of these Chinese art performing classical things that's been going on since 2006. It's called Shen Yu, and it's a classical performance of Chinese people and their dance and what they do and the culture from which they came. And I'm going to read you what he wrote. "I'm crying all the time because my heart is so full and so beautiful. This presentation is like feeding my heart, for my heart breaks for the traditional Chinese culture that is being crushed by the Communist Party. I'm hopeful that this will be the start of a renewal of Chinese tradition culture because it's so beautiful. And it's a blessing for me and my wife to be here. It's like a fundamental thing that all the Chinese culture flows from, the belief in the divine. Because the divine is where we came from, and it's where we're going, and it is the river. So that if you don't have the river, you're not going anywhere. You get the ugliness of our culture today, the Western culture. There's no life in the Western culture today. There's no hope. But I'm hoping that people will be filled with joy like me, and they will start to think, where did all of this come from? Why don't I have any joy in my life? How do I get some joy? Perhaps people will look to whatever religious belief they have and then plug into the divine, because it's the source of joy, and there will be no joy without heaven. What a powerful witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ in our world today. Joy. I'm prayerful that after you hear the words today, that you may indeed find some joy in the life of Jesus Christ and in the world in which we live. I realize today, and perhaps you do too, that there is a global war against God and all that we stand for. It's targeting our homes, our families, and our church, our values, and our systems. How do we get here? Some would say a lot of this stuff is coming through our educational system of our colleges and universities. One writer recently said, this unrest that's in our country has to do with young people who grew up during the Vietnam War, the Civil Rights Movement, and now the diversity of the colleges and the funding that comes from corrupt people throughout the world. Trying to explain it is very important, and yet we may not be able to explain it so well. But we realize that whether we watch TV or no matter what we do, or if we watch the wrong channels, we may not realize what's taking place. There's a global effort to get rid of our religion, to get rid of God. There's a war against God. And I've listened to a number of sermons online, and my heart is dismayed because in the last few weeks, I've listened to worship services where they never even mention Ukraine. Now, if you're not mentioning Ukraine and the troubles of the world today, you're in a glass bubble. And too often the church has been in a glass bubble. I mean, we can quote scripture right and left, but unless it's applying to our life and who we are. The war is bigger than ever before because of technology, because of the technological giants, because of the large banking systems who are in the critical control theory or crisis control theory. Because Russia, Iran, big tech, big banks, oligarchs, rich people, it's easy to lose heart in what's going on in the world today. But there is so much hope that's taking place in the shadows of all this stuff taking place. I bet you never even heard it. And I read the paper in this Epic Times that there was an organization gathering people, conservative people in San Diego, California. 3,000 people calling for the awakening of America. Wow. It's serious business, folks. And with all the people moving into our area, this church is to be a beacon in preparing and spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so with all that's going on, we have a lot of questions, do we not? And the best person to direct the questions to is Jesus Christ, Son of God, in this text today. Who are the worst sinners? Were the Galileans Were they so bad that Pilate killed them and that was the answer? No, says Jesus. How about those 18 people when the Tower of Siloam fell on them? Were they so bad? Well, if you want to put that in context today, were the 9 students and people killed in that head-on car wreck in North Texas a few days ago, were they worse sinners? Or was Jackie Brandt, that dog sitter, 22 years old, did you hear that story? She went in to check on 2 dogs. She's a lover of animals. And she opened the door and left the door open. Thank God that the alarm went off somewhere where people can hear it. But she went inside, and 2 dogs, one of which was a pit bull, took off her nose, her lips, her eyelids, and her ears. She lay on the floor for 37 minutes before the police finally decided to go in and to get past the dogs and found her. Was she a worse sinner than the other dog sitters? No. Were the 8 million Jews who were slaughtered by the Germans the worst sinners in the world? No. Well, then what's the answer? I'm not sure on this side of heaven we're going to have a lot of answers to all these questions, are we? You know, as I had junior high school and high school, I think we had 10 of my relatives were dying. Car wrecks, hanging, shootings, you name it. Part of my journey in the ministry was, how do we deal with this? My 12-year-old cousin Danny, his grandfather got him out of class unknown to his parents. He got a brand new saddle for Christmas. He's out roping steers. He had a tie down on his belt. A steer charged his horse. The tie down rope got caught on the horse's hoof, and they dragged him toward the pieces. Is he a worse sinner? No. I don't think we have very too many answers here, but I think we have a solution. The other side of heaven is going to give us some answers, but this side of heaven, there's a lot of brokenness. You see, the painful truth is that we live outside the garden. We live outside the garden, where the figs grew and everything was perfect, and God said, Adam and Eve, I'm going to give you some rules and I'm going to give you some choices. If you obey me, you're going to live in the garden. But what happened? God gave them the freedom of the will, just like he has given all of us. So I think part of the solution here is that to recognize that we're all sinners, big time, small time, doesn't matter. But God has a plan for life. He had a plan for life. His first plan blew up because of our sinful nature. But God had a new plan. He has a plan to break us out of that by the gift of Jesus Christ, who says, come back into the garden. Repent and come back into the garden and join me. And so the freedom of the will is a tough issue. I'm in a Bible study with a number of religious guys from other denominations. And they're always using the words, oh, Pastor Chuck, remember God is in control. Well, guess in my Lutheran upbringing and Martin Luther in my back pocket, I have to say, wait a minute. Yep, God has a plan. God can be in control of a lot of things. But the gift of grace, he has given us the freedom of the will. And that's what happens. Freedom of the will. You know, if you raise kids, like my wife and I have a son and a daughter. My son thought he knew everything about driving, you know. The first wreck he had was the best gift he ever got. It was a fender bender. But you see, my wife and I trained them with the rules and the regulations of how to live and how to drive. But there came a day where I had to give them the key. I was no longer sitting on the side telling them how to do it. They had to make their own choice. And that kind of goes up alongside or against the God control issue. Because can you explain 8 million or 9 million, how many Jewish people died in the Holocaust? God is control. Is that the kind of God that we believe in? No. But the God of grace and glory says, okay, I'm going to redeem you. I'm going to bring you back into the garden. And so it is that story that can give us a sense of comfort. Because God is in control in the sense that he's going to make all things right, and because death is not the final decision for our lives. Can you imagine what it's like to be 3.5 million Ukrainians who've left their country and their bank accounts and have gone to Poland and other countries? How they've sent their kids ahead of them just so that they could live? All sinners, yes. But God's response to a broken world is to raise up new people, new prophets and new preachers and new ministries throughout the world. And it's happening if we're just opening our eyes to see it. Because God is trying to turn us around and bring us back to Jesus Christ. And yes, when we confess our world is broken. But there's all kinds of hope. Hope that comes from people who are willing to not take it anymore. Who would stand up to school board people, who would stand up to governments, who would stand up to Putin's, and who said, I don't care what happens to me, but I'm going to speak the truth and I'm going to speak the gospel. For you see, in the darkest hour of your lives, God can be most visibly present, and the Holy Spirit can guide and comfort you. You know, it's a few months since the Olympics, but there was a couple of stories that you can find the gospel of Jesus Christ rising up in places you might not expect it. Scott Hamilton, for example, former Olympic gold medalist in 1987, he was born, that he was an orphan. And he was adopted and went to foster homes. And luckily he was in a foster home who finally adopted him and gave him lessons on how to ice skate. But his journey was not easy. You see, Scott eventually grew up to be 5'2" tall. And he only weighed a little over 100 pounds. And so he was bullied all along the way and considered sort of an outcast. Scott Hamilton survived prostate surgery as a younger person. He survived all of those issues along the way, and he was a faithful person, believing in Christ and in the Lord. And in his skating journey, he stumbled and fell, he calculates, 4,200 times on his way to the Olympic gold medal. He got up time and time again and skated over and over. 1987, he won the gold medal for skating. He ended up surviving another form of cancer in his brain. Scott Hamilton today is worth $40 million, has a lovely wife and 3 kids. He's an inspiration to us. When we fall down, we get up. Another story from the Olympic from the Olympics. A story of a lady named Brittany Bowles who won a chance to enter into the 500-meter skating race. But her teammate from America, Brittany decided, was much faster than her. So she stepped aside and said, I'm giving my spot to Kim Jackson. Kim Jackson won the gold medal. Brittany Bowles came in 16th. Friends in Christ, if that's not an image of what Jesus has done for you and me, he stepped aside. He gave his life. I'm going to the cross.
instead of you. I'm going to the cross instead of you. So friends in Christ today, you got to look around for places of hope, and it comes sometimes in the strangest place. Out of communist China, out of the Olympics, across the street, in the newspaper. Look for it. Because you see, when you do, you can even go to a Broadway play and have God speak to your heart. And your heart can be filled with joy overflowing if you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord. So we're here today to drink of his cup and eat of his bread, knowing that we have been empowered to face the challenges that are here today. May God add his blessings to our words and to his Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. I'm not doing a magic act, I just had to get my stuff up. Okay, I think now is the time to stand if you're able and to sing He Leadeth Me. Continue in our journey of faith as we share together the words of the Nicene Creed. Together we say, I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light,
true God from true God, begotten, not made, but being made with the Father, through him all things are made. For me and for my salvation, he came down from heaven, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was in heaven. For my sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. And I believe one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. Prayers of the Church. Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. O Lord, God eternal, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we praise you for the great things you have done for your chosen people. Through your special agent, Moses, you brought your people from tyranny and oppression to a land flowing with milk and honey.
For making the New Testament church your chosen people of Christ, and for making us part of it, we give you thanks.
We confess that we have not always lived up to our high calling in Christ.
We confess that we are often in our
We confess that we have often passed judgment on others rather than showing mercy.
For our failures and sins, O Lord, forgive us.
Send us your Holy Spirit, O Lord, to give us wisdom and understanding about your dealings with people. Strengthen us, O Lord, that we may also do your will.
Grant stability to our government and peace to our world.
Extend your hand of healing to the sick and grant substance to the poverty stricken.
Comfort the bereaved with the hope of a great resurrection and assure the
longing
of your presence.
And Lord, we lift up our hearts to you, calling upon your gracious bounty of rain for our land, calling upon you for some daylight in the midst of this darkness in our world today, empowering the leaders of the world to step forward, Lord, and to reclaim the precious truth that all children, wherever they meet, are your children. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for the life of Maggie and for the family of her family, Wayne Newman and Judy. And may you rest, grant her peace in your eternity. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for Joni Hudgens, who's in ICU with COVID. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for Marilyn, who lives, needs a liver transplant, but is not eligible. Please grant her peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for Marilyn Vinke, taken off of transplant list, infections that won't heal, kidney and liver slowing down. Bring her comfort and peace, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we pray again, O Lord, for all loved ones here, all people who lost loved ones. We pray here for this community as it grows
and stretches and tries to meet the needs of those who come to be a part of us. We pray for this church, Lord, for Pastor Greg and family, for all those who've been faithful throughout the years. We give you special thanks for Granny and her years of reaching out and calling children into the lap of Jesus. So, Lord, for all these things and all others we can name in our heart, we give you thanks. So, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And thus, in the name of him who suffered and died for us,
our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
You may be seated.
Let us stand and sing. Extravagant God, you have blessed us, the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast. We offer us the food that satisfies.
Take and use of what we offer you. Come among us and feed us with the body and blood of Christ. In whose name we pray. Amen.
Now our Lord Jesus Christ took the bread. And when he had broken it and given it to his disciples, he said, "Take and eat, this is my body. Do this for the remembrance of me." Also after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples to drink, and saying, "Drink of this cup, the cup of the new covenant, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you eat and drink of this bread and drink of this wine, you do in remembrance of me." And so together we pray our prayers our Lord has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and all places offer thanks. And we praise your name and join ending hymn saying, seated and come forward as directed by the ushers.
body of the Lamb of God, the body of Christ given for you, and the mark of Jesus Christ given for you.
Let us stand. Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body, the bread of life.
Blessed is the Lord, today your life-giving hope to the world and me. Amen.
Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and give you his grace. Therefore, go in the name and the peace of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Have a good.
Thank you. Oh, I'm trying to break.